another day where we are faced with the same old situation as always. It's Groundhog Day every day. Every day is the same. Very tedious. Seems like we're living the same day over and over again, with just some different wrapping, different packaging. Same product, different packaging. That day is a day where we are confronted with the one choice that we have. We only have one choice to make. Do we continue with deep forgetfulness of what we are, or do we decide to go with deep remembrance of what we are? That's it. There's nothing else at stake here. Only either forgetfulness or remembrance. That's it. It's the only issue. Just one issue here. That everyone is faced with the exact same issue. Forgetfulness or remembrance. Now, forgetfulness involves a vast circus. So it seems like there's a lot going on. A lot of different stuff going on. It's not. It's only forgetfulness of what we are. But to forget, to be in a deep state of forgetfulness of what we are, requires an enormous amount of distraction, misdirection, delay, huge production, ever-increasing production. Constant activity, greater speed, greater capacity to do things, greater hopes, great goals, achievements. Always a pot at the end of the rainbow, pot of gold. All of that is necessary. Tell ourselves our destiny as human beings is unlimited. We have to tell ourselves that. That's how we remain in a deep state of forgetfulness of what we are. For a while, just identifying with this world and with the body is enough. We have primitive situations, conditions. Goals are very, very meager, etc. But as we cycle through incarnations, we say, well, that's not it. That, you know, that seems to wear off. It doesn't seem to have the same attraction as before. So the forgetfulness wears thin, gets threadbare, and we need more goals, more activities, more potentialities. Become more sophisticated in our forgetfulness. Until when you get really, really tired of forgetfulness, and you've been there and done that, then you need super sophisticated goals. And you start getting into the higher promises of the ego. You know, I'm going to be a star. I'm going to be a galaxy. I'm going to become all this. Gets very grandiose. We're all going to ascend into a transcendent state together. all sorts of very, very super grandiose, even just on and on and on. That is all necessary to keep us in a deep state of forgetfulness of what we are. And when those don't work, then you say, uh-oh. I can't keep on keeping on with the mundane here. The grandiose doesn't work. The primitive doesn't work. Initially, there's a tendency to flee back to the primitive, trying to lose yourself in let's go back to the jungle and hunting and gathering and totally forget about all the sophisticated goals, because those don't work either. And one might do that, but then quickly sees that doesn't work either. So the remembrance starts to sputter. The forgetfulness starts to sputter. And you feel that something isn't working, and it's a frightful thing. And you can clutch at straws, you know. Human potential. I've got to find my potential. Where can I find my potential that will keep me from this edgy, uncomfortable feeling? Something that's about to happen. How can I stop that? Well, what's about to happen is your remembrance of what you are. Always that's about to happen. The dreamer is always about to awaken from the dream. And the dreamer is desperately trying to dream something more grandiose. To give more goals, something faster, speedier, more profound. Keep us engaged, stay engaged with this vast song and dance. Which serves to keep us in a state of deep forgetfulness of what we really are. What we fear is remembrance of what we really are. And we can, you know, dig through that fear endlessly. But let's approach it in a slightly different way. Just one choice today. Same choice as always. Every single day presents us this very same choice. Will always be that way. Until we decide on remembrance, because the only issue is, when do we decide? Is it today or is it tomorrow? The options are already set. Either it's deep forgetfulness or deep remembrance. Nothing we can do about the options. We cannot change those options one bit. We cannot change it into deep forgetfulness and deep remembrance at the same time, which would just cancel each other out and result in the feeling of total chaos. Doesn't work. So only when we choose is the only question. When are we going to choose, make the choice of deep remembrance? Because there again, that also is already set, because we have no choice but to choose that eventually. So again, the issue before us is, how long do we delay the inevitable? We can continue to delay. That's very possible. There's nothing that forces us to to choose right now. We can use our will to delay. But the game would be, you know, who can delay the longest? What kind of trophy do they get? They get the booby prize. Not even that. Who can delay the inevitable the longest? If the inevitable is simply remembering what we are is complete, flawless perfection and endless riches. And why is it an accomplishment to delay the remembrance of that? Is there some sort of prize, a special prize for that? No. There's no special prize. Remembrance itself is the prize. So if we want the prize, we need to choose remembrance of what we are. And in order to do that, it has to be effective. Problem is that we are attempting to continue to forget what we are, but to wrap it up in ways that we think, we believe, should be remembrance of what we are. There's the mistake that we make every day. Every day we go out and we're trying to remember, but without really letting go of forgetting. We've forgotten what we are to such a severe extent that the means that we use to remember, those are based on forgetfulness. For instance, we think that becoming famous will help us remember what we are. For sure many of us try that. I've certainly tried that. To get applause, you know, to have a crowd standing up and cheering you, and you think, wow, they all remember what I am. Otherwise, why are they so expressing such delight and love and joy towards me as a performer, as an athlete, as anyone who's on a big stage. So we think, wow, they're remembering what I am. Otherwise, why would they be doing that? So we look for other people's approval of us as if that were remembering. Because we think, well, they must see me as I really am, otherwise why would they be express such approval? Well, the truth is, they're expressing approval of performers because the performers help them forget what they are. And that eases the fear that they have within them. Because part of forgetting what we are is to tell ourselves a false story that it's justified, because what we are is terrible. Has been destroyed, and we're trying to forget that destruction of what we are. So people are very, very grateful in this world for those who help them forget what they are. That's why you see the quote-unquote stars, celebrities, those are performers. People are so grateful to them, saying, you know, you've really, really done a lot for me. And what they mean is, you really helped me forget, continue to forget what I am. we think if we develop some talent, like a performance talent. I used to have that, developed a performance talent, and then when we think that the skill, people will acknowledge the skill, this acknowledgement will, that's the remembrance we're looking for, is acknowledgement from others. Problem is that it's very difficult to maintain this skill. And the acknowledgement dwindles. Anyone who's been a skilled performer knows this. It's terrible. Because every day you feel your talent slipping away a little bit, eroding, diminishing. Because a lot of it depends on super reflexes and coordination and anticipation and very subtle nuances, and that all erodes with time as one ages. Or if one's skill is simply appearance, appearing to be beautiful and glamorous, that erodes too. You can see the horrible insecurities that these idols have as they age. Terrible. Being a celebrity, a superstar, a performer, all of that is horrible. Because one literally believes that this is the only means to remember what they are. And this is not true. So I have a good news for everyone here. That includes all those, you know, who are desperately trying, looking for acknowledgement, believing that's the only way, and suffering terribly from erosion of their skills to bring about this acknowledgement. To choose a different idea. Choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator. So this gets us focused on the real truth of the situation. First, we acknowledge that we're stuck, we're suffering, we're desperately trying, and we're realizing that what we're trying is not working. And then we say, well, what do we do? Okay. That's when the answer is supplied. See, all of existence is an attempt to forget what we are, because what we want to be is prime creator. We want to be the origin of all, of truth, of reality, of ideas, of everything. We want to be the origin of that. But the fact is that we are not the origin. We ourselves were created. So, the very fact of what we are is that we are created. We are an idea in the mind of God, an extension of God, in the mind of God, not leaving the mind of God. That very fact completely negates our assertion, our desire to be prime creator. We can't have it both ways. We can't be an idea in the mind of God and still be prime creator. So we are trying to forget reality, forget what we are, forget the fact that we are an idea in the mind of God, forget that ideas cannot leave their source. We have to try and forget all of that just so we can entertain the idea of being prime creator at some point. Just entertain this notion. We can't quite reach it, you know, but we feel like, well, we're getting there. And existence is this vast scheme that we set up to bring about this deep forgetfulness of what we are. So remembrance, deep remembrance of what we are, only comes about from deciding, okay, look, this is foolish. I don't want to continue on forever with this. How do I remember? Where does this deep remembrance come from? Well, it comes from choosing a different idea. And the effects of that idea are what provide us with the deep remembrance. And by choosing the idea of not wanting to be prime creator, letting that idea go, say, okay, I have the idea I don't want to be prime creator. What effects come from that? Well, one effect comes from it, just one. Not multiple, just one effect. And that effect is what I call the overlay. What others call the vision of Christ, vision of oneness, seamless garment, peace beyond understanding, Krishna consciousness, Christ consciousness, nirvana, samadhi, all these things, different terminologies. It's just one effect. It's not a dynamic. One effect does not make a dynamic. Or at least it's a singular effect. It's not a dynamic effect. Just like spirit is one idea, one idea in the mind of God. Perfect from the beginning, always perfect, never leaves the mind of God. So the overlay is flawless, perfect from the very beginning. Remains that way, always, endlessly. Is one with its source. It's not trying to separate from its source, the idea of not trying to be prime creator. It's not trying to separate from that, so therefore it's completely relaxed and at ease and peaceful with itself. It's not an effect that is embroiled in conflict with itself. No turmoil. Zero. So it's like a gentleness or a peacefulness beyond understanding. And it's only this effect that brings about the deep remembrance of what we are. It's not this effect in something else. It's not a dyad. It's not this effect in relationship with some other effect. It's not two effects becoming one. It's one effect, perfect in itself, perfect overlay. Overlay means we still perceive the world. The world doesn't need to change. Perceive it exactly the same as before, perceptual wise. But what we're experiencing is an overlay of all that. It's this vast, immeasurable, perfect peace that touches everything here, seems to overlay it. Even though it may seem to touch everything, it itself is untouched. The turmoil in the world does nothing to it. And so it's this overlay effect that brings about the deep remembrance of what we are. Only that. That's the means. Other means don't work. And so we need to, since we have employed other means for so long, the spiritual path seems difficult because we keep thinking, well, how come this way doesn't work? It seemed, I thought it would work, but it doesn't. And we have to clarify, why don't these other ways work? Well, because of what we are. Again, we have forgotten what we are. So we're just sort of assuming that the tactics that we have used should work. We think, well, it should work. But that's based on a false premise, a false image of what we are. What we are is, again, completely perfect and flawless from the very beginning, and extending that perfection and flawlessness endlessly. We're endless being, incapable of being distorted or changed, capable of aging or getting sick or dying. We're completely invulnerable, cannot be corrupted. And we're this way effortlessly, always this way, from the very beginning. And we are an idea in the mind of the Prime Creator. And ideas never leave their source. Their ideas extend. So we're an endless extension of the Prime Creator. Just remaining within the mind of the Prime Creator. This is what we are. And so there has to be an accurate means to bring about deep remembrance of what we are. And the overlay is this means. Most important of all is that there is no exception to truth, the truth of what we are, no exception to it. Therefore, the overlay can have no exception to it. It has to overlay everything without exception. This is crucial. Whatever means that can have an exception to it does not bring about the deep remembrance of what we are. Does not. And that includes whatever means that wasn't perfect from the very beginning cannot remind us of what we are. Cannot bring about that deep remembrance that we need. So if we feel our body has ever been vulnerable, it cannot, identifying with the body cannot remind us of what we are at all. Cannot bring about the deep remembrance, completely flawed way. If this world has ever suffered any death here, it cannot be a means to provide the remembrance for us. Cannot. If anything has ever aged here, anything has ever been sick here, it cannot bring about the remembrance. I mean, ever, stretching back to the very beginning. So it should be very easy for us to make a determination. And ask ourselves, has anything ever died in this world? Has a body ever died? Has anything ever aged? Has anything ever been sick? Has anything ever been broken? Ever been fragmented? The answer is very easy to see. So therefore, this world cannot be used as a means of remembrance. However, for the sake of continuity, we don't have to get rid of it. We simply overlay it. Allow the overlay, and then identify with the overlay. Don't identify with the world. That's the in the world, but not of it, that we're taught is possible for us. If we look at the overlay, we can ask the same question. Has it ever been sick, ever aged, ever died, any exceptions to it, fragmentation, etc.? None, zero. So, that then can work, will work as the means of remembrance. So that's a simple choice. We either choose to identify with the world or identify with the overlay. Choose the idea of being Prime Creator or choose the idea of not being Prime Creator. But the great thing about the overlay is it allows continuity. We still have a body. We're still in the world. We still see everything. Everything's the same as far as structurally in this world. Nothing changes, but we don't identify with it anymore. We identify with the overlay. Because our purpose has changed. Our purpose is now remembrance. And so it's the overlay that brings remembrance. So we're focused on that. Our purpose is no longer forgetfulness, so we're no longer focused on the world and bodies and all that activity. It's not important. We still recognize it's still there, spatially, structurally. We're not in denial of it. No need to deny it. Simply, it no longer serves our purpose, so it's not important. It has no more relevance. Its relevance has been replaced by the overlay. It's the overlay. It's not that we're in a vacuum. No. We now have the overlay to identify with, and we see that, this truly brings remembrance of what we really are. And then we just abide in that remembrance. Let the remembrance deepen. Sort of marinate in it. Submerge ourselves in it. Like getting into a bath or a hot tub or a swimming pool or an ocean or some air conditioning, some shade. Just sit there quietly and just enjoy it. Because that's our purpose, is now remembrance. So of course, those whose purpose remains forgetfulness will be frantically working on that. And as their motivation lessens, they'll frantically try and get some kind of tiny burst of remembrance, so that'll remotivate them to keep trying to forget. Sort of like that. And they will not see the utility, the usefulness of the overlay. They will only look at it in terms of how can the overlay motivate them to continue to try and be successful in forgetting. Because again, the story we tell ourselves is that we are forgetting what we are because it's necessary. And it's necessary because we say that our point of origin has been destroyed. Our home has been destroyed. What we are has been destroyed. And so we must create a new reality, a new identity, a new beingness. And we must forget what we were. That's the story that we believe. We're telling ourselves that. It's a motivational tactic. But we must remember that we're only telling ourselves these very wicked, crazy stories, untrue stories, because we want to be prime creator. So we're being sort of dishonest. We're deceiving ourselves. We're lying to ourselves, saying that everything has been destroyed, reality has been destroyed, and that's why we're doing this. Not true. We're doing it because we want to be prime creator. So we must acknowledge this fundamental deception, self-deception. We're not telling ourselves the truth. We're not acknowledging that we've made up this scenario of reality being destroyed and that we had to flee from it and that we're exiles and we cannot go back home. Therefore, we must pursue being a new creation, a new reality. We're the origin now. We're all that's left. That's all a make-believe, made-up story. Serving as a marketing device, motivational device, to continue the effort to be prime creator. So of course, those who are telling themselves this tall tales of the destruction of reality and fleeing into exile, etc., they think those who are trying to remember what they are crazy. Because they think that their remembrance will bring about this picture of complete devastation and will be overwhelmingly horrible. So they think that they're absolutely nuts. And they're desperate to help them not do this, thinking that by helping them not remember what they are, they're doing a great service. So, one might be perplexed by the attitude of others as you move towards remembrance of what you are. Others do not support this. They They think that's the worst thing possible, that it's a sign of severe weakness and that everybody needs to help one another not do this. So again, it's important to repeat these basic truths, because the forgetfulness of these truths and the attempt to turn you away from remembrance of what you are is so strong here in the world, because everyone here, almost everyone, is engaged in this massive self-deceit, this tall tale of being an exile, fleeing from the destruction of reality, the devastation of the prime creator, and that we had to leave. You know, we had no choice. Just the opposite. We're the ones who chose to leave, to try and leave, because we wanted to be prime creator. Nothing ever happened to the prime creator, to reality. Reality is completely untouched. It's exactly the way it's always been. We invented this nonsense to motivate us, as if we have no choice. We had to be the new prime creator because the old prime creator was destroyed. And so trying to remember the way things used to be is complete folly. It'll result in some picture of annihilation that will drive us completely insane. That's what we've been telling ourselves. That's the tacit ideology of this planet. Ever anyone truly wants to remember what they are, they get this full dose of persuasion not to. And these false ideas. Now, when one tries to have both deep remembrance and deep forgetfulness of what one is, that results in an experience of total chaos. I have experienced that. Because the world holds this up. What happens is, you come in this world and you want to bring deep remembrance and tell the world about this. The world rejects this and says you're crazy, because deep remembrance of they believe deep remembrance would be deep remembrance of complete annihilation, and that's to be avoided at all costs. So they say, well, okay, let's make a bargain, a compromise deal. We'll have both deep remembrance and deep forgetfulness at the same time. Why don't you teach that? And we'll maybe accept that. And so I said, okay, let me see how this plays out. And what I found out was that plays out as total chaos. And that is totally unexperienceable for more than an instant. It's like touching a very hot plate. You move your hand back and instantly, like you're being burned. Total chaos really is not experienceable for more than an instant. I experienced it, I jumped back and said, it's impossible to remain with that. So the technique of trying to provide a compromise doesn't work. For sure it doesn't work. 100% sure of that. So from that point I said, okay. Compromise absolutely does not work. You cannot do both. The same time, it's impossible. Now, then I tried vacillating between the two. That just creates extreme stress. Tears you apart. It's so stressful. Because each one is denying the other. It causes severe anxiety. Instability, feeling that you don't know what you are really. You're aimless, purposeless, chaotic. Very bad. So that doesn't work. Both at the same time doesn't work. Oscillating provides a horrible experience. Various mental troubles that people suffer from are because they're trying different ways, different compromises, different techniques. They're not trying the overlay. They're trying various compromises. That brings about various things like different mental troubles, emotional troubles. All the troubles come from trying out different compromises, different techniques. So I examined all of those things and then experienced what does it feel like. And through all the different, maladies that people suffer here in the world, simply trying to see, you know, what is it that the world is trying to do? All these different compromises, things. You know, what do they feel like? They're all terrible. So most people simply try and to forget as much as possible. And that seems to bring about the least amount of suffering. Because it's not in conflict with itself so much. It's when one tries to do both forgetfulness and remembrance that suffering gets intense. The problem is, of course, that we are tired of forgetfulness. And so we want to remember. So inherently, we naturally will go back towards remembrance and we'll try to do compromises. And then we really suffer badly. So those who think that they are getting off scot-free and that they can continue on with forgetfulness forever, it's not true. They will get tired of it. And then what will happen is that they will start moving towards remembrance and they'll start trying to combine the two. And that's when the mental problems occur. Suffering, different types of suffering, horrible suffering. The suffering that people who are dedicated to forgetfulness are experiencing is, you know, it's the run of the mill. It's the tedium, it's the boredom, it's the sicknesses, it's the indigestion, it's, you know, all these things, and they try to tamp down any of the deeper miseries. So they seem to get through life, it's, you know, well, you know, some pleasantness, ups and downs, etc. But it's when one tries to combine the two, remembrance and forgetfulness. On the path back towards remembrance, there's inevitably one will try and accommodate both positions. That's when the suffering suddenly develops teeth that you didn't know, and it's a shock. And you think, my gosh, I used to feel not so bad. You know, life wasn't that terrible, wasn't great, and was full of instability and anxiety, etc. But I managed to, you know, stifle that pretty well. But now, what is this? I seem to be in the grip of some terrible dynamic that is simply tossing me here and there. And those are the deeper afflictions, the afflictions that come from trying to accommodate both forgetfulness and remembrance. Make accommodations for both of those. This brings about the extreme, terrible suffering here. And those who have not yet done that cannot relate to it at all. Guaranteed, that's a fact. When one is in the jaws of that type of suffering, it's as if the world doesn't understand it at all. They think that they'll say that you're just weak-willed. They'll tell you to just snap out of it, shake it off, get going. Get some distraction. Have a good time. Take a rest, etc. All these things that they do that work for them because they're still pushing just the forgetfulness. But those things don't work anymore. Typical damping down things, distractions don't work when one tries to accommodate both deep forgetfulness and deep remembrance. Terrible conflict arises, and the things that used to work to just get rid of, you know, various irritations don't work anymore. That brings about a state of great concern, and other people cannot relate to your situation anymore. They say, gee, I don't know what's wrong. You can't just snap out of it. Maybe you should just get a new job, find some new friends. Get a hobby. So they're well-meaning people, are well-intentioned, well-meaning, but they're just giving you advice to how to continue on with deep forgetfulness. And they don't realize that you're in conflict now between deep remembrance and deep forgetfulness. Those two, trying to accommodate both. That brings about this horrible, horrible raging storms. And one doesn't know what to do about it at all. psychology, psychiatry, they don't know what to do about it either. So what do? Take some pills, take some medicines. Those don't work either. If the conflict gets severe enough, those don't work either. The only way that works is to resolve and decide that one cannot accommodate both, and decide which way one is going to go. But accommodating both results in incredible suffering, insufferable suffering. I've experienced all of it because I wanted to really experience what the trouble is here in this world. What is the trouble? Clear it up. The suffering becomes insufferable. And the only thing that keeps one going is simply the interest in what's going on here. Why is it insufferable? But people do become suicidal in this world because they're trying to accommodate both deep remembrance and deep forgetfulness, and it becomes intolerable. And they think they just cannot continue on with this feeling of intolerableness. But the remedy for that is to say, where is this intolerableness coming from? Be interested in that. That's the spiritual path. At some point, one has to simply dig in and say, I'm going to resolve this. I'm very interested in why this suffering is so terrible. What's causing it? And then that banishes the suicidal feelings. They're still there, but you are that which has interest in why is it there. It's like you're a detective on the case. And sure, the horrible case is still there. But now you're the detective. You're the one who's going to solve this case. So you recognize that there's this intolerable conflict within. But you say, okay, I'm on the case now. And when this attitude is taken, one inevitably, at some point, one gets a glimpse of the remedy. And then one says, aha, okay, there is a remedy. And I have to find it. There is a resolution of this intolerable conflict that I'm feeling. I have to find it. I'm on the case now. All the therapy, all the pills, all the advice, etc. in the world doesn't work. Only choosing a new idea works. Only experiencing the overlay works. That ends the conflict. Because one is not trying to accommodate both deep forgetfulness and deep remembrance at the same time, or make accommodations for both in the same house. So there are stormy seas on the spiritual path, stormy seas. And the world does not recognize what's causing this. And so the advice the world gives is not accurate. Even though it seems to be well meant, it's not on target. So I came to the world, I really wanted to clear this all up. See exactly what's really taking place here. And especially the deeper sufferings, the mundane sufferings. You know? That's not that important. It's obvious. It's the deeper sufferings here that seem to be very mysterious. The torments that people go through and the things they try to do to remedy those torments. What causes that? Because you get some very fine people here in the world, very intelligent people. They seem to suffer the worst. Very sensitive people, because they're trying to accommodate both within themselves of both deep forgetfulness and deep remembrance, as they start to gravitate naturally back towards remembrance, there's an attempt to accommodate both, and that brings about the agony. The chronic fatigue and the weak nerves, lack of confidence, lack of energy, lack of will, lack of motivation, feeling of just being dead, feeling of being conflicted, all these horrible things. Those occur to people who are seem to be, you know, very bright. And nobody seems to know what to do about it. As the world discards wisdom, there seems to be no hope then for these people except pharmaceuticals. Or maybe some sort of therapy. But if one can simply hear the truth of the situation, it changes the perspective greatly. I can speak to this directly. I've been through it all. Don't need to go through it again. Experienced all of it, the entirety of the situation here. Even the complete chaos of trying to simultaneously be in a state of deep forgetfulness and deep remembrance, that's the worst. That's a suffering so terrible it can only last one instant. And then from there, you go through all gradations of horrible suffering and agony, mental torment, and wear and tear on the body, the emotions, the mind racing nonstop. Insomnia comes from the mind racing nonstop, because the mind's trying to solve this problem of how to resolve this chaos. And seeing the chaos, the mind says, "Oh my gosh, how can I bring order to this chaos? How I want to have both simultaneously, but it's causing this chaos. So how do I control it all?" And the mind is just races uncontrollably, and one can't sleep. One will just sit there, lie there at night, and the mind is just out of control, going a million miles an hour like a wildfire. Horrible. Terrifying. Again, that comes from trying to accommodate both deep forgetfulness and deep remembrance. And there's all gradations of this. All different degrees of severity. But one can literally remain in that state continuously. And then it becomes so intolerable, one wants to turn to something, to some way to dampen down this mind and the fatigue and the anxiety and the panic. So, tremendous misery that one has to face that. It's called the dark night of the soul. Historically, that's a term that's used. As one turns back towards remembrance and then automatically attempts to accommodate what it's familiar with, which is forgetfulness and remembrance at the same time, one is plunged into the deep despair and depression and fatigue, stress. It's horrible. But that can be a lesson when there's a situation, culture or situation in the world where there's an understanding of what the situation actually is. It doesn't have to be that bad. But when there's an ignorance of this, as there is now in this world, it can be very, very terrible. Nobody knows what the problem is. I went through all of that. Nobody had a clue what the problem was. I experienced that, and I saw that, and examined that, and said, nobody knows what's going on at all. Completely ignorant. But in, I also saw that there are other situations and cultures, etc., throughout history, where there's been more wisdom, that there has been ways to lessen this trouble. And there really has to be a culture of, and ways to lessen this trouble. Otherwise, it's too difficult. It's ferocious. So really, in the big picture, one has to look towards a situation, a wisdom culture that is based on clear understanding of this entire situation. And you wonder, well, it's very in vogue today to criticize religions, etc., for various reasons, some of which are justified. Because of distortions and that have taken place. But the basic premise of religions is really, it's to build a culture of wisdom, a wisdom culture that is based on completely clear understanding of the entire situation, what's really difficulty, and therefore make it easier for people to move towards deep remembrance and get through this difficult phase of trying to accommodate both remembrance and forgetfulness. That horrible phase that one has to go through, like a terrible march, to make it a lot easier to have support in this endeavor. Support. A support system. It's very important to have a support system. Very important. Trying to go alone like I did, ridiculously difficult. But I did it because I wanted to experience the entirety of the situation. And really, really have a first-hand experiencing of it, so I know for certain of exactly what's taking place. But from this point, of course, I see wisdom culture has to be brought about. Very few are going to make this march without support system. They're going to go off the deep end. It's too difficult. I had some support, subtle support, but not a culture of support. The wisdom in this world doesn't exist right now. Does not. Even the gurus here don't quite have it clear enough. Not generating a culture of wisdom, so to speak. Not so much. They're not speaking directly to a situation. Yeah. Clear enough. So it's very, very beneficial if one finds oneself in a wisdom culture in time and space. Because then one can go for it. And of course one will still experience difficulty, but it won't be so severe. Won't last so long. So ultimately, from a practical standpoint, it's extremely important for wisdom cultures to be established. And in this world right now, is the opposite is happening. What's happening here is an emphasis on forgetfulness and an emphasis on treating the symptoms when one tries to accommodate both positions of forgetfulness and remembrance, treating those symptoms with pharmaceuticals and various therapies which only treat the symptoms, overlook the cause of it. This is not a wisdom culture. That is my observation of this planet now. It is not a wisdom culture. We are basically jettisoning wisdom culture here. Getting rid of it, throwing it overboard. basically saying that what we can do is succeed at forgetfulness, which is absolute folly. But realistically, one should not be too upset with oneself. It's difficult here in this world right now. Very difficult. The underlying support systems have been eroded. They've been demonized. The world has been hacked. This support system, this culture of support for the spiritual path, has been hacked. It's been undermined. It's been termited. Efforts to somehow establish a wisdom culture here. There are efforts taking place, but very questionable if it's going to really take here. There's a tremendous amount of demonization of wisdom culture now, of true wisdom culture. It's couched in terms of, like, hatred of religion, etc. But it's deeper than that. It's a rejection. People are afraid of taking the spiritual path because they sense that there's some suffering there, some deep suffering. They don't want to take it, so they want to turn towards forgetfulness and try to reinforce that and to dismiss the spiritual path altogether. And so they feel that a wisdom culture will attract them to the spiritual path, and they don't want that. It's an understandable fear, but it's a rejection of one's responsibility, really. One has to go through the fire. One has to walk over the hot coals. So one might as well make it as easy as possible. You know, that should be the attitude in this world. It's basically, there's a tough job that has to be done, so we should make it as easy as possible. That's it. Take every step possible to make it easier, and go for it. That's a wisdom culture. Wisdom culture says this is your responsibility, this is what you have to do, there's no exception to it, you can't be excused from it, you have to do it, and it's very difficult, it's going to cause you suffering, but so let us make it as easy as possible and do it. That's the attitude. That's the attitude of real religions, real wisdom cultures, is very tough, you know. It's a tough attitude, tough love. Tough love is the only thing that really works. It's saying you have to do it. So, but again, there needs to be a support system in place. Culturally. Deep, wide-branching, wide-ranging support system that has been in place in history, really, that enabled people to really excel and push through this quickly. Those support systems are under unrelenting attack right now. Have been for quite some time. From people who themselves, they don't ever want to take that path. They want to avoid it forever. And so they want to destroy any support system for this path. They just want to sit and watch frivolous entertainment. There's nothing wrong with eye candy and entertainment, etc. But it has to be part of the spiritual path and the support system. Like these videos here, maybe there's some nice, you know, pictures, background, but the purpose is profound. That's the right use. All entertainment has to be given the right use. Used to be that way. We used to have safeguards. Culture used to have safeguards. Not anymore. And people claim that these safeguards were really repression or censorship, etc. The highest goal, the highest purpose, the highest value is remembrance of what we are. That's the only one, only thing that's valid and important. So the idea that certain things should be banned, should be, you know, on a list saying these this type of entertainment, etc., is bad for you, it's ruinous, it's simply frivolous, it's going to cause you more suffering, so we're putting on a list saying do not attend these shows, etc., don't watch this program, etc. That's extremely helpful. And there's a, you know, fight over that, saying that's censorship, etc. Well, freedom of expression is not the highest value here. The highest value is remembrance of what we are, choosing to experience the overlay. That's incomparably the highest value. It's the only real value we have here. And so the means that we use should be in alignment with that value. So if a wisdom culture will absolutely put restrictions on various types of expressions, absolutely, always have, always will, things will be banned. Many of the things that that this modern culture is engaging in absolutely will be banned. Rightfully so. Again, the highest value is not simply self-indulgence in whatever one wants to do here in this world. It's providing the support system to take the spiritual path so that one can finally choose the overlay and experience deep remembrance of what one is. That is the only true value in existence. So the means must serve that end. So those who are simply trumpeting free expression, do whatever one wants to do, engage in any sort of behavior one wants to engage in, it's all free expression should be covered under freedom. That's foolishness. Those do not realize that inevitably they too will have to take the spiritual path, and if they don't have a support system for it, they will experience horrible suffering. And they will regret the frivolousness of their previous engagements here. And they will wish, deeply wish, that they have a support system. And that these things that are so ruinous to remembrance in the spiritual path, they would wish that those things would be banned. Because they're terrible distractions, horrible distractions. Basically, as one goes towards remembrance, these distractions are calling one back into forgetfulness. And then that brings about a feeling of needing to accommodate both. And that brings about horrible sufferings, very deep psychological, mental, emotional sufferings. Nervousness of all types. So, you cannot have the inmates in charge of the asylum, which is what is taking place here. You cannot have those who are ignorant of the entire situation in control and making crucial determinations. But we have that now. It's like people say, oh, hey, as long as it doesn't hurt anybody or whatever, everybody should be able to do exactly whatever they want to do. It's a completely short-sighted viewpoint. Complete ignorance. Foolishness. Because one must take the spiritual path, and the suffering on that path can be horrible. And so, one, by saying, well, just let's do whatever we want to do, doesn't matter. Eventually, that will result in horrible suffering. Because one is torn between remembrance and forgetfulness. So it does hurt others. culture, this culture we have now, does is extremely hurtful. People say, well, as long as it doesn't hurt anyone else, it is hurting severely down the road, both now and down the road. Those who are trying to remember what they are going toward that direction are being torn apart. Those who are trying to be responsible are being torn apart. They are being hurt by it severely. And then those who preach this doctrine of do whatever you want to do, well, it doesn't hurt anyone, then they just say, well, the remedy is just to give up the spiritual path then and just indulge in the senses and debauchery of this world, and then it won't bother you. You know, give it up, in other words. If it bothers you, give it up. If you don't like it, just ignore it, so to speak. Foolish, 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 foolish advice that will end up causing enormous suffering for those who have tried to take the spiritual path, and during these times, enormous suffering, enormous difficulty. And for those who will follow under these type of doctrines, terrible difficulty. And again, everyone must. There's no choice in the matter, it's only when. So, it's completely incumbent that wisdom culture be ascendant. And that the foolishness of those who don't see this, who don't realize what they must eventually do, they must eventually be responsible. They cannot be the ones establishing the rules. Right now they are. They're the ones who are establishing the rules. And so it's a ruinous situation. Because people will not take the spiritual path under these circumstances. It's too difficult. I wouldn't advise anybody to take the spiritual path under these circumstances, really. In other words, to start out. If you've already gone a long ways, then you've got no choice. You've got to finish. You know, you cannot just go halfway. Once you start, you've got to finish. So these videos are to help you finish, encourage you to finish. But as far as expecting people to start out under these circumstances of this world now, I wouldn't do that. It's too difficult. So I would absolutely put restrictions. I would say everything on television, none of those programs would be aired. It's not that we would dispense with television, though. There's vast amounts of programming that could be helpful. Simply isn't happening. Same with the movies. None of the movies would be produced. The entertainment, same with the entertainment. None of the entertainment would be entertained. None of it. So, very, very ill-serving the purpose of the spiritual path now. So it would be like a cultural, complete cultural remodel is necessary. Complete. It's in such disarray right now. Terrible. But the question is, can that happen right here, right now? It's unlikely. As I have said, it is more likely that there will be a relocation of some sort. A spiritual culture is very possible. I've studied it throughout history. There have been times and places where this did take place. The great wisdom traditions, various Judaism, Buddhism, Zoroastrianism, Jainism, Christianity, Buddhism, Islam, Hinduism, and others. All of those, you know, great, great traditions, wisdom traditions, managed to set up some support systems and to minimize the efforts to drag the world back into forgetfulness only. Forgetfulness of one's responsibility here. But the modern world has eroded those situations. And the momentum is towards really complete marginalization of those traditions and a redefinition of them and a watering down of them. Serve our purpose at all. Does not serve a sense of responsibility at all. The world is becoming entirely irresponsible. I know I live in the Silicon Valley. It's the heart of irresponsibility. This is where it's coming from. That and other places. Los Angeles. Area, big cities, hearts of entertainment, information, entertainment, technology, innovation, all of that. Those are the hearts of irresponsibility. That's what's leading the planet astray. And these trends are very powerful trends. They have managed to take over the educational system and marginalize the wisdom traditions. And so you have generations growing up have been completely indoctrinated into the notion of demonizing wisdom traditions and then feeling righteous if they give them a little pat on the back and say, you know, we'll accommodate you here if you just, you know, shine our shoes. Pick up our garbage, and you can do these things for us. We'll let you stick around, but clearly, the wisdom traditions are now the lowest on the totem pole. They're seen as without really real value. They're seen as anachronisms, kind of like a doddering old, aging person who's kind of got dementia, and people let them stick around and give them some care. Understanding that they're on their way out. That's the attitude that's coming from Silicon Valley and from the places of influx of this irresponsibility. Is that all these wisdom traditions are anachronisms, like an appendix that needs to be removed, that's on its way out. And they're simply greasing the skids, saying, you know, you're irrelevant. Your past, your passé, we know better. So we'll accommodate you, give you a little shack somewhere and until you die, but you have no relevance in the future. This is, again, complete folly. The height of folly. The height which comes from those who think they have some way to bring about a total forgetfulness of what we are and be prime creators. It's spiritual pride. Spiritual pride says that the spiritual path doesn't need to be taken, that spirit can succeed in being prime creator. It doesn't need to remembrance of what it is. It's going to create itself anew. It's a new creation. That's called spiritual pride. The world is immersed, submerged in spiritual pride, drunk on the wine of spiritual pride right now, primarily through technology and entertainment. The capacity, the wedding of technology, high technology and entertainment, the marriage of those two, and information technologies, all of that together, conglomerate of that, is spiritual pride. And the world is, again, completely drunk on that pride. So from my observations, I see that if relocation took place, I wouldn't be surprised. I don't know how spiritual aspirants can get through the present muck. What happens is one sets one's sights lower, much lower, into what's called spirituality. therapies, spiritual therapies, all different types, healing therapies. That's not remembrance. Again, I pointed out earlier in the video, what has to take place for remembrance is experiencing an effect that was perfect from the very beginning and always remains that way. So healing therapies don't address this at all. What they say is, well, you were sick, you were dysfunctional, but now you're not quite as sick and you're not quite as dysfunctional, and that's, let's call that good. You know, that's not it. That's what arises when the wisdom culture is destroyed and spiritual pride is ascendant. You get all these therapies that says, let's call this good. Done. That's what happens. When you go into these places, these New Age bookstores, for instance, that used to have a lot of wisdom traditions, and there's still some accommodation for that, but it's marginal. It's been marginalized. I've observed that over the decades. And now you have just this ascendancy of spiritual therapies and modalities, all sorts of treatments, alignments. And there's an entire vast culture of spirituality. That's what they, tough love, they'll say, look, you have to get through this. It's a very difficult phase you have to go through. And so we're here to support you and provide the right type of support. Especially saying that you have to succeed at this. Like my guru, one of my gurus, Sri Nandamayama, would say, suicide is out of the question. Okay, completely out of the question. You absolutely cannot do that. Very helpful. She said it's the greatest sin there is. You cannot do that. So in hearing that, you know, no matter what terrible situation you're feeling, being torn into pieces, you realize that's not an option. It's not an option. At all. See, that's tough love. Wisdom traditions provide the right kind of love. Tough love and the right kind of supportiveness. There's both the tough love and also the right teachings have to be present. Have to have the right kind of teachings, the absolutes, focus on absolutes, as I've said in other videos. Never impossible, always futile, entirely, completely. Those are absolutes. You have a situation that helps one focus on those absolutes, and that's the only way to eventually get past this horrible conflict of trying to accommodate both forgetfulness and remembrance. One has to get through that. So the means to get through that quickly need to be present, or else it drags on too long and becomes so difficult. One can put up with suffering for a while, but when it drags on, then it really, really, really becomes very troublesome. So moving through the spiritual path quickly is very important. But these modalities now of therapies in the world, the idea that you can somehow do it in a couple days is ridiculous. Completely ridiculous. You get a contact high, of course. Again, that's just a modality. It's a spiritual modality, a treatment. Not a path. Wisdom traditions recognize there's a path. It's difficult. Another great teacher, Jesus Christ, in the Course of Miracles said, it's difficult, it takes quite some time. You'll go through different phases. Some of the phases will be very tough. He's very clear about it. It's tough. You'll experience frustration and difficulties. You'll be torn in conflict. You will go through these things. But you must prevail and persevere. There again, acknowledgement, there's a very tough path to go on. Acknowledgement, it takes time. Acknowledgements that you must persevere. And then providing the support in the terms of using absolutes and clarifying what the situation really is that helps you move through it. That is wisdom tradition. That is what really works. Thank you. us the help we need. And today we're not getting that. We're getting this notion of pay a certain amount of money, go on a retreat, go see this guru teacher, and should be able to do it in, you know, a week or two. Should be finished. Well, it might finish off someone who's already gone through the path. And is, you know, the fruit is already completely ripe, ready to drop. That might work for them. But that's about it. Might give some little but the emphasis of the idea that it can be should be done quickly, like taking a pill, is ridiculous. No way. There's absolutely no way that can ever take place, because one is coming from a standpoint of extreme familiarity and belief in forgetfulness, and a belief that forgetfulness is absolutely necessary because reality has been destroyed. And coming from that place and having to move toward a place of completely choosing total deep remembrance, realizing that it's all this been made up. And to go from one extreme to another, inevitably one is going to grab a hold of the idea of having both. Maybe we can accommodate both. It's inevitable. Theoretically, one could do it quickly, but not practically. And so a lot of the notion that we can do it quickly, that's just theory. It's not practice. It doesn't happen that way. It will not happen that way. And so really we're relying on pills. And pills have side effects, as we know. Spiritual pill doesn't work because it does not acknowledge the difficulty, the actual extreme difficulty that one goes through, the dark night of the soul, because one will try to accommodate both. It's inevitable. The success stories you see of quickly awakening are those who have already gone through the dark night of the soul, already worked it out. And the fruit is ready to drop. That should absolutely be emphasized. And one should get the right talk and explanation, as I'm trying to do. That there is an inherent extreme difficulty on the spiritual path, and there therefore needs to be a tremendous support system engages in the right type of tough love and support and teaching. Otherwise, very few will take the path. Very few. So ultimately, I certainly expect some sort of support system could come in the form of relocation, as I have said before. I'm not ruling that out at all. I have gotten indications that this is certainly a possibility, a possible option. It's in the background. If it happens, it happens. If it happens, it's a welcome thing. Perhaps the situation will be more austere, greater austerity, greater simplicity. Not all this tinsel and frivolity of this planet now. But there needs to be a strong support system, cultural, deeply embedded, a culture based on right premises. It's not here right now. I don't see any possibility in the near future that it will take place here. World has been basically taken over by hackers, by those whose purpose is to keep the world oriented as a place of forgetfulness. They want the world to be a place of maximal forgetfulness, and they are pushing it in that direction, and they have pushed it in that direction to an extreme extent, and will continue exponentially to conform this planet into a place of extreme forgetfulness. Like a resort, a forgetfulness resort, a resort of forgetfulness. And of course, they will come here for all sorts of modalities of treatments for what ails them. Superficial stuff. With a veneer of sophistication, a veneer of spirituality. Spirituality in this world now is a veneer. Largely a veneer. And I have all these drugs here. They already have them, but they'll be all legalized. And all sorts of debauchery will be legalized. Much of it already is. It'll just be like a pleasure planet, sensuality planet, a place of maximal forgetfulness. That is how the world has been configured already that way, and yet will become even more that way, which is why I say, because the spiritual path is absolutely unavoidable. And there are those who know that for sure, completely clear about it, that fashioning a place where there is a support system for the spiritual path has likely been an extreme priority, as this world has been conformed to a place of absolute forgetfulness. Extreme forgetfulness, not absolute, it's impossible. Absolute forgetfulness is impossible, but extreme forgetfulness is very possible. And the efforts to turn this world into a place of extreme forgetfulness have succeeded. And this has been seen ahead of time. So it's very likely that those whose purpose is to bring about a place of maximal support for remembrance, that they have been working on a world conformed to that purpose. Very, very possible. Very likely. Very likely. Because they know, they look at this world, they know what's going to happen. It's foreseen. And it has happened, already happened. This world has been conformed to a place of extreme forgetfulness. Through and through some more. Therefore, it's very likely that there is also a place that has been conformed to help the spiritual path. Conformed to bring one towards choosing a new idea and experiencing the overlay. Place that is customly designed to help that. Very likely. High likelihood. So, do not despair as you look at this world and say, oh, how can I succeed here? It's so difficult. Or, I despair about the future of my children and grandchildren in this world. How can they take the spiritual path under these circumstances? Don't despair. Very possible there may be a relocation of those who truly want to be responsible, to face their responsibility of deep remembrance, and to go through the difficulties that are inherent within that choice, and to end their delay, and to get with it, to suffer the rigors of the spiritual path with a support system in place. So take, lift your head up, and realize that this is very possible. All is not lost. Yes, this planet has been lost to forgetfulness, but this isn't the only planet there is. This isn't the only situation there is. All is not lost. And for those who have taken the spiritual path and have deep into it and have moved through a lot of these difficulties, there's still support here. I'm trying to give all the support I can within the larger context of realizing that this planet has been conformed to forgetfulness. And it's not really plausible for teacher to come out and no teacher can change the situation right now. Nobody can make a flip-flop. It's too entrenched. And no teacher can come out and solve the problem in, you know, a couple days retreat. It's not possible. So there's a certain limitation on what anyone can do right now on this planet, because teachers function within the context of a supportive wisdom culture, So they basically, teachers, encourage us to take the spiritual path and to succeed on it. But without the support system, this encouragement pulls us into suffering, severe suffering, that we can hardly deal with. So if a great teacher were to appear in this world right now, without the wisdom, culture, and support, it would result in dragging us into tremendous suffering that we might not be able to cope with. That's why you don't see the great teachers appearing in this world anymore. And I don't think they will. I think it's more likely that they're supporting a relocation. Some people call it ascension. And that they've spent their efforts designing a situation that is extremely supportive of the spiritual path. I think that's a much more likely situation. So we've covered a lot of ground here. Very profound ground. And it's been very enjoyable to work on this here and make it available for those who have the ears to pay attention to it.